Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining me for the coveted last speaking spot of the day. Hopefully, we'll try and keep you entertained here for the last 20 minutes or so. So what I'm going to talk about today is why it's so important to have developers as part of your security team when you're talking about the cloud. I assume that most of you are probably security experts and cloud security experts at that. But there's a very important reason why we need to add developers into that security expertise, and that's what I want to talk about a bit today. A big part of the reason why this needs to happen, right, is that the cloud has really changed how we fundamentally handle infrastructure and our applications together. No longer is it just servers and storage and network, and then we pile some application things on top of it. The cloud and the infrastructure is a part of the application itself. It's created in code. It powers the application, right? The cloud services are a functional and important piece of the application. And so it's really important that all of those things are secured together. We can't run a secure application if the infrastructure is broken. We can't run secure infrastructure if the application is broken. Both of those things have to happen together in order for us to really and truly run secure services. And the people that are creating these are developer types. They're people that are working in code. They're working in IDEs. We don't need to wait until something is deployed and then look for security issues. We can identify security issues while it's still in code early and get it fixed before it gets deployed. And that's the sort of change that we want to make. Unfortunately, today, a lot of times, we still handle these things in different silos. So we have teams that work on code security. We have teams of developers that are working in the code all the time and AppSec teams that are focused on the code side of things. And then we have infrastructure and cloud teams who are focused on setting up the cloud and setting up infrastructure securely. And there are cloud and infrastructure security teams that are working with them. But generally speaking, unless there's a critical issue, they are working in different silos and working in different circles and separate from each other. And that's not the way it should be, right? You can go to probably 90% of the booths at the show today, and you'll see some version of this infinity loop. But really and truly, it's broken unless we fix this problem. And so that's what we want to try and figure out. How do we do that, right? How do we remove those barriers? So our developers, our operators, our security teams are all working in this cycle, and we're actually creating this virtuous loop that makes our applications and our cloud better together. The other issue here, aside from the technology pieces of it, is probably one that most of you here are intimately familiar with, and it's just there aren't enough of you, right? And there never will be enough of you. For every security person, security expert out there, there's a security job opening, and there aren't enough skilled people to fill those openings. In reality, if we can take those developers, and we can take the DevOps people, and we can get them involved in security, right? We can get them fixing issues much earlier in the process, then we can fill that security gap within the organization that we have today. But we need to help those people get there. They're not security experts, and we can't take our traditional security tools and throw it in front of them and hope that they do the right thing, because it doesn't give them the sort of information they need. Now, with application security, we've started doing this, right? There's a lot of talk. You'll hear everybody talking about shifting left, which is a great concept. Unfortunately, it sort of stops short in a lot of cases. What we've done is we've taken security tools and we've moved them into CI/CD. So we've shifted the tools left, but we haven't really shifted the audience. We haven't really shifted the responsibility, right? We want the developers to see the results. We want developers to know exactly what to do and where to do it. And to do that, we need to be even further left. And we need tools that produce information that a developer understands and can use as they're creating their code. So we need to move it over into code. We need to move it over into the Git repos, and we need to take that security information and we need to flip it around and focus on here's the line of code that's wrong and here's what it should say instead to make that security alert go away, because the rest of the details aren't as important to them. And with this shift in cloud, we can do the same sort of thing with our cloud configurations as well, right? As more and more of the cloud is defined in code today and created early and sits in our Git repos, we can apply that same principle, those same processes and techniques to our cloud security. Our cloud workload protection doesn't have to start in the cloud itself after our workloads are running. Our cloud workload protection starts in the IDE. It starts in the Git repos. It starts when somebody creates that configuration we can start the security checks there, and we can start fixing things there, right? And that gets our security, that gets our developer into our security team. We also need to connect the cloud back to code, right? So we need to scan everything early as it's created, but we also need to look at things that are running in the cloud. There's a really important context that comes from the running instances in the cloud, right? We need to have a policy engine that connects those two things so I don't get different results in my IDE than what the cloud's team is seeing running in the cloud at the same time. But I also need to know things like, if something has drifted away from what I created in code, how do I go back and fix that? Did it drift because it was okay, it was good, or did it drift because it was bad? Somebody went into the cloud console and started clicking buttons instead of going into IAC to fix it. I need to have those, that bit of context. We can think about things like an S3 bucket. Every IAC tool in the world is going to tell you that an S3 bucket that has public access is bad, right? But is it really bad? Well, if it's got public access and it's accessible to everybody on the internet, then yeah, that's probably really, really bad, and we want to fix that. But if it's accessible on the internet in IAC, but our AWS setting says we're going to ignore all public ACLs, then in reality, I don't have a publicly accessible S3 bucket. And I don't have that context unless I see both of those things together, right? So I need to have that cloud context to really know what's important to fix as a developer. And again, as a developer, if I get one bad result, I'm probably going to ignore the rest because now I don't know what I should be doing or what I shouldn't be doing. What do I need to pay attention to? What can I ignore? So everything needs to have the right context, and I need to know that I can trust it. And I need that feedback loop from the cloud in order to be able to do that. And it's not just about our cloud. Again, our cloud and our apps are so interwoven together that we need to see everything in one place. They're going through the same process. They're going through the same pipeline. But the cloud also provides really important context to the application itself. So the cloud can tell me if I have a vulnerability, whether that vulnerability is actually accessible to anybody outside of my environment or not. And that changes, you know, my need to stay over the weekend and fix issues, or I can come back on Monday and fix it later, right? It's really important that I have all of these things in one view. And if I just have one tool, one application security tool or a cloud security tool, then I miss that combined view of the world that's so important to developers and to security teams and to operations as a whole. So let's walk through a scenario and kind of think about how this might apply in the real world, right? And Log4j is probably the one that everybody's super, super familiar with. And so let's talk about that. What does it look like to have a tool that actually tells a developer how to fix it, right? If we have a cloud security tool, most cloud security tools will tell you you've got the Log4 shell vulnerability, right? And they'll give you important contextual information about where it is, what zone it's in, what region it's in, what cluster it's in, what the container names and those sorts of things, right? And you'll get a CVE, and the CVE will give you information like it's fixed in version 2.15 or whatever it was for Log4 shell. All really important details that are necessary for the fix. But as a developer, they're not sufficient for a fix, right? Because that doesn't tell me what line of code I need to go and change to make this vulnerability go away, right? It tells me what I need to change it to, but I still have to do the hard work of going from that alert in the cloud back into my code and figuring out what needs to change. And it gets trickier, because 60% of the cases of log for shell, at least the ones that we detected in our customer environments, Log4 shell was an indirect dependency. It was a transitive dependency. That means as a developer, I can't just go look for log4j in my dependency list and find it because I didn't put it there. I put some other dependency, and that dependency had a dependency, and that had a dependency. And so somewhere buried in that dependency tree was log4j, which means I can't, even if I can find it, I can't just change that. I have to change the dependency that I added. And so it's really tricky to sort of work backwards through that to figure out exactly what line of code needs to change and what do I have to change it to make this vulnerability disappear, right? And again, only by having the complete context of the cloud and the application and the code can I actually help a developer fix that problem without spending a lot of time, you know, digging through it. And again, it needs to go all the way back into the places where the developers are, right? So this is, you know, very much needs to be inside the developer's tool. It needs to be inside the IDE. It needs to be inside the Git repos, right? We have to go from that alert in the cloud to something a developer will see straight away, and we'll tell them exactly what to do to fix it, or even better, automate it, right? We can open a branch and put in the fix, and then they can go through the automation process to test that and make sure that it actually works for them. So that's how we do the application in the cloud together. Let's talk about the cloud itself, right? And issues that it can appear in the cloud. We talked about things like a simple example, like the S3 bucket, right? And why it's so important to have the cloud context there to know whether our S3 bucket is properly protected or not. But there are lots of other issues that can come up in the cloud itself, which need to be addressed in code, in the infrastructure as code, right? You're going to see loads of alerts that pop up in your cloud environment, and you need to know exactly what's going to be fixed, and you need to be able to help a developer understand what they need to do to fix those things. So drift is a great example of that, right? We need to find resources that have changed from the time I've deployed it until this instant. But I need to know whether that change is good or bad. There's a colleague over in the Snyk booth who's got a great line. He said, look, we're all at this show today. That's an anomaly. Is it a bad thing? No, it's a great thing. We're all here and we're having a great time and we're learning a lot. It's a good thing, right? So an anomaly doesn't necessarily mean that it's bad. I need additional context to be able to determine whether whether that unmanaged resource is bad or not. I need to know whether that unmanaged resource is misconfigured, the same way I would need to know if it was in the IAC directly. And then I need to try and capture that back in IAC so that I can properly audit it, properly secure it going forward. The prioritization is absolutely critical here as well, right? Again, I'm going to get, if I just go scan IAC, I'm going to get a ton of, alerts and things that are thrown up. But as I go and I look at their whole entire cloud context, which most application teams don't see, they see their one horizontal view of the cloud, right? Their one application. But if I bring the whole picture in, right, they don't need to know all the details, but they do need to know where their application sits inside of there. And if there are firewalls up, beyond their control that are going to protect their application, that means there are a whole lot of those alerts that can go away, right? And so that type of context is really, really important. So again, in the cloud, we need to be able to see this entire environment. We need to provide that protection from code to cloud, and then from the cloud back to our code, so that our developers can do the right things. For all of us as security experts, it means fewer alerts, right? It means we don't have to wrestle with as many tickets and nagging people to go fix those tickets. It means that it shows up in the tools that they use every day so that they can go take care of those issues directly. And that's really what Snyk is focused on, is making this loop actually work, right? From the time somebody creates an application, from the time somebody starts creating the code that's going to define the cloud services that are going to be used, let's start protecting it. Let's protect it when it's running as well. Let's protect that in production. And then let's make that loop back, that feedback loop to the developers that tells them, the additional context that they need to make the application better on the next cycle. It's something that developers are used to. When they write code, they improve their code over time, right? They look at the stats and the statistics and the application performance, and they make their code better. And security really doesn't need to be any different. It needs to follow that exact same cycle. And it really needs to link all of these teams together into that true DevSecOps solution. So from a Snyk standpoint, we cover all of those parts, right? We cover the application itself and all the open source dependencies that people use. We cover the containers and the IAC that people use to define the cloud. And this week, we are debuting our Snyk Cloud product. So if you go to the Snyk booth, you can see a demonstration of Snyk Cloud in action. If you're familiar with Fugue, Fugue is a company that Snyk acquired back in February, and the Fugue team is here. They're great. I encourage you to go talk to them and learn more about it. But you can see all of the Snyk products, and you can see them all in action if you want to go into a deep dive demo. We have lots of resources that are available for everyone as well. We have handouts at the booth, and you can, of course, find a lot on Snyk. And if you want to get to Snyk software, you can, of course, get to us on the AWS Marketplace and find us there. Are there any questions? No questions. All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Appreciate it. Have a good rest of your day.